Hello everyone, welcome to Kalam's answer writing session for the day. So today I have another brand new question to tell you all. The question is on a scheme called Jal Shakti Abhiyan. So there was an article in the editorial yesterday which was talking about the inadequacies in the policy and the implementation of the scheme. So that is going to, so a question has been framed on that particular scheme, and we will discuss how to address that scheme. As usual, before we move forward to the question, we will first list down the prerequisites. So what is the importance of these prerequisites? It is basically going to structure your mind. So it is basically going to streamline your mind into different blocks: a block of polity, a block of scheme, a block of disaster management. And whenever a question comes, it comes in relation to one of these blocks. And whatever prerequisites you have in that particular block, you're going to write an answer in relation to those prerequisites. Okay, so that is the point of having these prerequisites. It is going to help you customize your answer to the needs of the question. So what are the prerequisites for a scheme based question? The first thing is to talk about the provisions. The second thing is to talk about the committee reports in relation to that scheme, if any. If it is a Jal Shakti Abhiyan is a relatively new guy, it's a relatively new scheme. But if you have a big scheme like Manrega, we also have committee reports, especially you have CAG reports in relation to that particular scheme. If it is possible for you to write, write it down. And the third thing you have to keep in mind is the article. So whatever scheme we have, it basically hits one of the articles in the constitution. Like for example, if there is a scheme for old people, it in relation to that, we can talk about that relevant article in our directive principles of state policy and list it. Okay, so when you do this exercise continuously every day, when you make it a point to read the articles and keep them in mind, by the time you go to the exam, it comes automatically to you all. You will be able to write the relevant articles when you write the answer. So these are the prerequisites which are required. So in the most important prerequisite among all these is the mentioning of the provisions, because when you put out certain facts, it is going to increase the trust of the examiner in you. It is going to make him believe that you know what you're trying to tell him. So always learn some certain provisions of the schemes, and if possible, memorize certain facts. For example, the funding for Manrega is how much? 40,000 to 50,000 crores. You have a ballpark of the schemes, ballpark of the scheme provisions and the funding and so on. Okay, so now we will move forward to addressing the question. Before we write the intro body and conclusion structure, we will read the question once and segregate into themes. By themes, what I mean is what are the subparts in the question. So even though the aim and the intent of Jal Shakti Abhiyan are noble, it has some inherent defects in its policy and implementation. Analyze the statement and suggest suitable measures in this regard. Now look, so when you look at this question, prima facie, I see two themes in this question, as in I see two subparts. First subpart is that I have to talk about the problems in that scheme in relation to policy and implementation. This is going to be my first subpart. And then the second thing I need to be talking about is about the suitable measures of the scheme. So these are the two things I have to keep in mind. These two things have to be definitely there in the answer. So this becomes the skeleton of the answer. So now we have to build the flesh and muscle. Okay, so what is it going to be? Introduction, body, conclusion. The moment I read the question, I've understood that I have to talk about two things. One is the defects analysis, and the second thing I need to talk about is the measures. This is going to be the skeleton. So how do I start my introduction? There are different ways of starting an introduction. One is the current affairs article, and the second is the definitional approach. When you write a scheme, it is better to start with a definitional approach, because when you start with that, you will be writing the essence of the scheme. For example, Jal Shakti Abhiyan is related to water conservation. So when you put that name down, when you throw that name of water conservation in the first 2-3 lines itself, he'll understand that you know what you're talking about. That is important. And a third way to start in this particular context is to start by using a quote. ओके वन वे कोर्ट इज़ रिलेवेंट वेन वाटर बेस्ड कोर्ट्स तो बहुत हैं ठीक है. वन ऑफ दोज कोर्ट्स कैन कम अप इन योर आंसर टू प्रूव दैट देर इज़ सम काइंड ऑफ वाटर स्ट्रेस विच इज़ विच विच मीन्स दैट वी हैव टू कंजर्व अ वाटर. सो यू कुड स्टार्ट लाइक दैट एज वेल. ओके and once we do that we move to the conclusion, 1-2 line conclusion, and we finish the answer. So let's see how we can enrich this particular answer. So we are talking about defects, we are talking about measures. So what else can be done before we directly jump into the body? How about writing the aim and objective? For example, he could have directly asked the inherent defects in Jal Shakti Abhiyan, but then he started out by saying something, right? He started out by saying that the aim and the intent of Jal Shakti Abhiyan is noble. You have to somehow warm up the body of the answer by telling him that the intent and aim of the Jal Shakti Abhiyan is positive, but there are certain problems or defects in relation to policy and implementation. So we have to have some measures to address the issue. Okay, so this becomes a holistic approach to your answer. So this is going to enrich your answer. This is what has been asked, and intro and conclusion are mandatory. So this is the structure of our answer. So we are sorted. We will move forward and see one of a student's answer and evaluate it. Okay, so let's look at this answer. So he started out by saying, with only 4% of world's freshwater, India hosts as high as 16% of the world population. So he's basically showing you the mismatch. There is only so much of water India has, but there are so many people India has. So there is going to be a mismatch between these two. So when you have a mismatch, there is a need to conserve the water. So that is what he's trying to tell us. This creates a situation of water scarcity, further aggravated by pollution, depleting groundwaters, droughts, etc. So this is a good introduction. It is basically telling us that there is a problem of scarcity. It is establishing a problem of scarcity in this in terms of water. Now I assume he'll move forward to talk about the way in which Jal Shakti Abhiyan tries to conserve water. But remember, Jal Shakti Abhiyan is only for 255 districts, which are the most critical in terms of conservating water. So let's see how he handles the rest of the answer. See, he is warming up. Aim and intent of Jal Shakti Abhiyan is noble. So what he is doing, he is mimicking the nature of the question. He has actually taken those words, he has put them down here. He is talking about the aim and the intent. Water conservation, this is the essence. Groundwater replenishment, this is just a provision. And then he is putting out certain facts. Focus on 255 water stress districts, district and block level conservation plan, creating a people's movement, and that it is time bound and mission mode. This is mostly generic, but this is adding weight to my answer. And then he is talking about convergence with MNREGA and integrated watershed development program. So if you see how many points he has listed here, he has listed about 7 points here, and he has taken only so much of space. So I want you all to notice that when you have a format like this, when you put up diagrams like this, it is going to help you write more in less space. Okay, and remember that this has not been asked. The aim and intent of Jal Shakti Abhiyan is noble. He didn't ask you to establish it, but we are doing it because it is going to increase the well-roundedness of the answer. So once he did this, he is talking about the defects in policy and implementation, because that is what has been asked. And remember, he is not talking about general defects, he is talking about the policy defects and the implementation defects as asked by the question. He is customizing this answer in such a way that the question is mimicked in the nature of the answer. First thing he is talking about is the funding problem, because funding is not separately allocated for the scheme. And the second thing is the involvement of several ministries. When you have several ministries, there are several ways of liaisoning. There is no proper coordination. There is red tapeism. There is bureaucratic control, and so on and so forth. All these things come. So whenever you write a scheme-based question, no, you most likely you have all these problems: implementation hurdles, policy implementation problems caused by red tapeism, and then there is no coordination. All these things come up, but they become generic points, but you have to write some specific points. Let's see if he does that. See, he's talking about district boundaries are focused for conservation plan, but instead hydrological boundaries should be considered. So this is an important point. The main problem with the scheme is that it doesn't consider the hydrological boundaries. What you have to keep in mind is that water does not know boundary. It just flows from high point to a low point, from a high potential to a low potential, whichever be the boundary. It doesn't recognize political or international or any kind of boundaries. So you have to streamline your scheme in relation to hydrological boundaries. That is what he is trying to say. So this is an important point. It should have come first. Okay, so keep that in mind. And the next what he has written, groundwater and aquifer maps were not used, thus decreasing the science in the scheme. So basically he is trying to say that it is not as scientific as it is supposed to be. And then reliance on MNREGA and integrated watershed development makes the Abhiyan a mere super sensor or a coordinator. So if everything is done under MNREGA and integrated watershed development and other schemes, so if this scheme is basically acting as a coordinator between all these things, what is the essence of the scheme? Is what has been pointed out by him. Next, this might increase red tapeism in implementation. This is basically a repetition. They shouldn't have been there because he already mentioned bureaucratic hurdles and red tapeism. But it's fine. People's movement for water conservation has not been up to the mark. See, the aim of the program is to bring about people's movement, especially in the rural areas and the most critical water stressed areas, so as to conserve the water. So this people's movement is not up to the mark is what he has written. So overall he has written 6 points, out of which 4 of them seem to be solid and quite relevant to the question. So this part is satisfactory. So far, what has he done? He has warmed up the body of the answer. He told me what the provisions are in relation to Jal Shakti Abhiyan. He has given me so many points. And then he talked about the policy and implementation challenges in that particular scheme, how the funding is not sufficient, how district level boundaries are being considered instead of the hydrological boundaries, which should have been considered, and so on. So he basically so far established the problems in that scheme. Now what do I want to see as an examiner? I want to see the solutions. Okay, so let's see what he has written. Way forward and solutions. Way forward and solutions, that is what he has done. Scientific cropping in water stressed areas and movement away from sugarcane, etc. What he is trying to say is that you have to converge this scheme with the cropping pattern. If you just work on your scheme in isolation, it is not going to help. You also have to teach the farmers not to cultivate water intensive crops. And you're supposed to do it is what he's trying to say. If it is a people's movement, you're also supposed to make people aware of the fact that faulty cropping will lead to depleting groundwater levels. Okay, so that is what he's trying to say. Considering hydrological boundaries instead of political boundaries. This is a good point, but this seems to be a repetition, because in the problems itself he has listed that it is a problem, and now he is telling you have to change it to give a solution, but it is fine. Increased funding and coordination, it's the same. People's awareness through campaigning, intensive afforestation, this is a good point. When you increase afforestation, it is going to conserve water. Mass mobilization to SHGs and PRIs, this is good. So the novel points that I've got here are this and this, because these have already been listed as problems. Okay, now we will move forward. I have few thoughts on this, which this has been deliberately written, so I'll tell you why. And now we will move forward and see. In addition, scheme should be supported by water experts for successful implementation. This is basically a generic conclusion which he has given. He has written so much. This is a decent answer, but we always, as civil service aspirants, as people who want to develop into good personalities, we want to see how to improve this answer. See, these two things are basically repetition, and why I call them to be repetitions is because I've already listed them as problems. So when I want to give them solutions, I want to give them something specific. Like here I'm talking about scientific cropping, and here I'm talking about afforestation. So these are new points. So I don't want any kind of repetition when I read your answer. So you have to keep these things in mind when you write an answer. And the third thing, and the next thing which I want to talk about is the conclusion. See, yesterday also we've seen a question in which the person has given a two-line conclusion. Here also he has given a two-line conclusion. So when you have situations like that, there is a trick to handle the issue. When there is a time crunch and a space crunch in relation to your answer, what you can do is to take the last point and put it down in the conclusion. Through mass mobilization, through SHGs and PRIs, this scheme can be streamlined and moved forward for successful implementation, something like that. So the last point you're supposed to write, you can actually put it in your conclusion so that your conclusion becomes dense, so that your conclusion doesn't look generic. All right, so that is one trick you have to keep in mind. So this is the learning for the day. So I think this is the important part that I've told you all today. Whenever there is a time crunch in relation to a conclusion, use the last two points you're writing. Try to put them in the conclusion, okay? So that is going to help you put up a 2 to 3 line conclusion, which is not generic, okay? So the discussion for the day is over. What do? We go back home, we write the answer, and then we upload it in the platform, okay? Thank you.